Hi, this is Carl with another SOP video for managed service providers. In the previous two videos, we talked about the server build documentation. So first you order the server, you got some stuff there, you take delivery of the server, there's some paperwork and so forth in there. Today we're going to talk about the server build itself. Now there are three stages to documenting the server build. The first one is you have to look at your network documentation binder, which hopefully you have for each of your clients. And this is something that will contain all the information about their network. Now, some of this might be in electronic format, some of it might be in a printed format. Wherever you keep it, it doesn't matter. We're going to refer to it as the network documentation binder. So you're going to look up the things you need to know before you build the server. Things like, what IP address range does it have to have? If you're going to have an ILO, do you need a separate address for the primary NIC and the ILO? If you have a second NIC and you're going to team them, you need to make that decision, right? So will they each have separate IP addresses or will you combine them? Right? Those kinds of decisions. What's the name of the machine? What's the name of the domain, right? So you have to gather up all those things you're going to need before you start building the network. One of the things that we always do is we create a nice little map for our clients. So it's a network map and we know what the IP address is of the router and the printers and so forth. And all of that is stuff that you should have handy as you're building the server. The second thing you need as you're building your server is your troubleshooting and repair log. Now, I'm going to link to this below, so I've written lots about the troubleshooting and repair log. It's pretty straightforward. We always start a troubleshooting and repair log before we start a server build or any major project build, simply because something might not go perfectly right, and we need to be able to trace our steps and know what we did and what we didn't do. And you can use a form like I have pointed to, or you can just use paper and just write down whatever you have notes on, but you should be rigorous about this. The key to success with a troubleshooting and repair log is that you put something down every time something important happens or every 15 minutes. So even if you're going to have these marks that say continue to load at 15 minute marks, that's okay. You need to be able to look back and say, did it take me 40 minutes to build a server or did it take me 2.5 hours, right? So whatever it is, you need to log that. Now I have a separate blog post where I talked about building up this HP server onto an SD card. So it actually boots off of an HP SD card. And that took me a little bit of trouble and I had to have several takes at it before I got it right. So all of that is documented in the troubleshooting and repair log. As a result, at the end, I can create a process that I know I can execute in 2 hours that will be successful. And I don't have to do all that thrashing around. And it's because of the troubleshooting and repair log. Now, here are the kinds of things that you enter as you're building your server. It's really easy to remember. Anytime you're asked to answer a question, write the answer into the troubleshooting and repair log. Things like, what name did you give the server? What password did you give to the management console? What username is this? What password is that? What IP address is here? What choices did you make in the setup? Anytime you answer a question, put it in the troubleshooting and repair log. Eventually, you're going to be able to pull out of that the things you need to actually document this server in a way that's useful to somebody else. Finally, the third thing you need to document when building a server is after it's all done, you need to put together just a few pieces of information that are critically important. Remember back in video one of this series, we talked about the spec sheet that you got when you ordered the machine. So that's the basis of your machine documentation. So we do have a machine spec sheet, and of course you can fill that out and keep track of that separately, or you can just write notes onto the spec sheet that you got from the distributor. Either way, it doesn't matter. But the point is, there's a handful of things that you're going to need someday, and they should be written down. You can put them in the binder, you can photocopy them, you can put them online, put them in an Excel spreadsheet, doesn't matter. They have to go somewhere. Here's what the goal is. When somebody on your team needs to get to something on that server, how do they do it? What's the username? What's the password? What's the address, right? You don't need to document every silly little thing on that server. You might do that for a network analysis or a security analysis or something, but today we need the most basic things. You call tech support, what are they going to ask you? Well, what's the name of the server? What's the IP address of the server? What's the serial number of the server, right? What's the support tag? On and on and on. There's just a handful of things that you need to have. Those should go on your server spec sheet, and that way you'll always have them. And of course, anytime you touch anything that affects the rest of the network, be sure and put that into the documentation as well. Obviously, I've got an entire book on network documentation, so I would love to have you go buy that, but you can really figure all of this out. Just follow the one simple rule. Whenever you're asked a question, write down the answer into your documentation. For Small Biz Thoughts, this is Carl Polachuk, wishing you the best of luck in your managed service business.